You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
If you're 85 or younger, would you like peace of mind and comfort for your family? We're Final Expense Direct with an urgent message for you. The average funeral today costs over $8,000, but the most you'll get from government benefits is $255. How will your family pay the difference? We can help. Our senior plans start as low as just a dollar a day and pay up to $30,000 for a funeral and other final expenses. Peace of mind is easy. There's no medical exam. You'll have lifetime coverage, and your plan can't be canceled as long as you pay your premiums. Call now for free information about our senior plans. Answer a few simple questions and receive approval right on the phone. Plus, call right now, and we'll give you a discount prescription card for free. Call 800-553-8687. That's 800-553-8687. Again, 800-553-8687.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Sometimes riders feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our riding into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable riders to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
My name is Jessie, and I'm proud of the life I have, surrounded by military and aware just how big the world really is. I have a unique perspective on life and the world around us. If you're willing to listen, I'll tell you how I see it, and I won't pull any punches. This is my POV, which stands for Point of View. All right, how's everybody doing out there tonight? Yes, it's Jessie. Yes, I miss you when we're not talking. All right, don't forget, I'm over in the chat room, klrnradio.com/chat. Chat with me live while I'm on the air. So if you are listening to the sound of my voice right now, and you are listening live, and you will know if you are, definitely join me. You never know what I'll say in chat that doesn't make the air. All right. I have... Oh my gosh. I am appalled again at what I heard at the UN Security Council today. And yes, that is the show prep. Oh, by the way, speaking of death and tragedy, I do want to mention, remember I brought up the last male northern white rhino that had been living under guard. Well, unfortunately, he was 45 years old. He was euthanized after his health took a sudden decline over the past 24 hours. He was unable to stand and suffering a great deal. And it was age-related complications. So that means there are only two northern white rhinos in existence, and they are Sudan's daughter and granddaughter. The second to last male northern white rhino died in 2014 at age 42 at the San Diego Zoo. The conservancy that has been taking care of Sudan was cautiously optimistic 2 weeks ago when Sudan appeared to be recovering from treatments for his age-related infection. However, unfortunately, it was not to be. Sudan did live in captivity the final 38 years of his life in order to protect and care for him. During his final years, Sudan came back to Africa from a zoo in the Czech Republic and stole the heart of many with his dignity and strength. The survival of the species, however, depends less on the death of Sudan and more on the health of the two remaining females, because semen from dead northern white rhinos is stored around the world. However, his daughter Najin and his granddaughter Fatou would need to reproduce through in vitro fertilization, a technique which is still being developed. So we'll have to keep an eye on the white rhino population. I decided to start you off with something a little on the lighter side. Because I can only take so much of the UN Security Council and Guta in any one day. And I apologize for that. I normally have my phone on silent. And unfortunately, I had neglected to do so. I was using it right before I came on the air, so I do apologize. That is very rare. Anyway, back to our stories. The UN Security Council was talking about the tragedy that is Ghouta. Yes, once again. They have been meeting and working tirelessly, trying to come to a solution. Because there are a great number of people that are still trapped in Ghouta, and they are on a starve or surrender plight. This is a tragic and unfathomable situation. I can't begin to express how I would feel if I were in their shoes. I am fortunate that I am not. I do have some audio clips from today's UN Security Council meeting. Now, this was not a normal meeting. And that is expressed by our other ambassador to the UN. And I just have the last name of Curie. I forget the first name. I will get it to you most momentarily. However, she expressed absolute, utter outrage.
We also note the participation of so many delegations here in the hall today, so many who would not have otherwise turned up for this council session had the procedural shenanigans earlier today not occurred. So while it is shameful that some members of this council sought to prevent the High Commissioner for Human Rights from speaking on this topic today, and we've seen the lengths that some members of this council will go to hide and distort the truth about what is happening in Syria, we are so proud to join our colleagues in refuting this cynical effort and showing that it will not succeed, that human rights do have a place in the Security Council. In fact, that effort has failed spectacularly, as this full chamber attests.
Okay, so the point she is trying to make is, A, there were procedural shenanigans, yes, and we can only guess by whom. She didn't name them, but there's only one person who is a permanent member to the UN Security Council. Who could pull procedural shenanigans. And that would be Russia. On Monday, Russia blocked a meeting of the UN Security Council to discuss the human rights situation in Syria. And they said that their reason given was they don't see any justification for the meeting, since human rights is not a subject on the agenda of the Security Council. Keep in mind, as I have said many times, Russia is propping up Bashar al-Assad. Yeah, this guy. However, France and six other members had called for the meeting, which was expected to include a briefing from Zayed Raad al-Hussein, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. Because they felt that the Security Council needed to have all the necessary information to understand the crisis that is Syria, so they could come to better decisions. A procedural vote was asked for, and only eight delegations voted in favor of having the meeting, one short of the number required. Those who voted to hold the meeting were, alongside France, were the United Kingdom, Sweden, Poland, Holland, the United States, Peru, and Kuwait. However, what they did was amazing. They held an informal meeting so that the information could be presented. While it was not a formal meeting as such, at least the information was brought to light. Let's listen to a few more of the audio clips from our ambassador to the United Nations.
It is absolutely appropriate for the Council to focus its attention on the victims of the Assad regime's atrocities in Syria. It is absolutely appropriate that the Council focus on the more than 13 million people suffering inside Syria, more than half of whom are children. These are innocent children, like the five-week-old baby who was rushed to one of the few clinics still functioning in eastern Ghouta after an airstrike killed his entire family. The physicians trying to treat him, however, quickly realized there was no formula left, and unless this child could get some kind of nourishment, he would also die. At the same time, a young mother was rushed to the same clinic, bleeding after being hit by an airstrike, and had to have her hand amputated. She was also the sole survivor of her family, having lost her own newborn. The doctors realized that the young mother was still producing milk, and by joining these two together, orphan child and bereaved mother, this child was able to have the chance to live another day. This child and his mother deserve more.
Can you honestly say that a baby and his mother don't deserve better treatment than this? Wait till you hear what else Syria appears to be up to.
They deserve better than the government that removes critical medical supplies, even baby formula, from aid convoys. Children are dying as a result of these removals and the regime's systemic surrender or starve campaign against the people of eastern Ghouta. The depth of depravity to which the Syrian government and its backers will sink is unfathomable. Of course, for a regime that is willing to systematically torture its own people, its own children, starving them is nothing. The Assad regime, along with its backers in Moscow and Tehran, should immediately adhere to the Resolution 2401 ceasefire, cease their hostilities, and allow unfettered humanitarian access.
Russia has blocked the ceasefire and continued fighting despite voting for the ceasefire. All right, let's take a look at, listen to a few more of Kelly Curie's comments at the informal Security Council meeting on Syria. I do have just a few more for you.
The regime continues to imprison tens of thousands of Syrians, including women, children, doctors, humanitarian aid providers, human rights defenders, and journalists, subjecting them to torture, sexual violence, inhumane conditions, and denial of fair trials. Numerous UN reports have repeatedly documented the massive, synchronized nature of deaths in state-controlled detention facilities and conclude that they amount to crimes against humanity and war crimes. This is why we are here today and why we keep talking about these issues week after week. This is also why certain member states don't want these facts exposed. Those who survive Assad's torture cells suffer devastating and lasting damage, as do their families. We reiterate the many calls from UN bodies, including this council, for the Syrian government to cease its egregious abuses against its own people and allow for immediate unfettered access to medical service for all detainees.
Oh yeah, you think that's bad? Unfortunately, that is not all. That is not all. There is more, but not all of the comments, I feel, should be aired. Remember, she called out Moscow and Tehran for their failure to adhere to Resolution 2401, which is the ceasefire, cease their hostilities, and allow humanitarian access. What can I say, except both of these countries that have been called out, in my opinion, are bad actors on the world stage? It is behavior I expect from one, but I'm not entirely surprised to see it from the other. Now, there is much going on about the UN nuclear deal. While I'm not going to go into the details of the deal, suffice it to say that whether Iran is living up to it in whole or in part, only they know truly. However, all current evidence leads us to believe they are not. Iran claims to have used its power to defuse all regional threats against the country. And this is according to none other than the Ayatollah Ali Khamenei. And this is as tensions rise once again between Tehran and Washington over the influence of the Islamic Republic in the Middle East. Yes, Iran is once again rearing its head in a very ugly way on the world stage. Now, as the Ayatollah is prone to do, he did not cite specific threats. He spoke in platitudes and grand statements. However, Iranian forces have, but he appeared mainly to be referring to the Islamic State militant group, which Iranian forces have confronted in Syria and Iraq, as well as at home. If you were a regular listener to this show, you will recall I read reports of not one, but two terrorist attacks in Tehran. Tehran is not a city known for having terrorist attacks. Shiite Iran has also been locked in a regional power struggle with Sunni Saudi Arabia, which has been extended to the war in Yemen, where Iran, none other than Iran, is supporting the Houthi rebels and building military bases and weapons factories. And once again, this war and conflict is spilling over into yet another failed state called Lebanon. Of course, Khamenei said that last year the Islamic Republic defused regional threats. One of their aims was to harm the Islamic Republic. These threats did not damage our country but turned into opportunities. In November, Tehran declared the end of Islamic State of Daesh and hailed the Iranian soldiers killed fighting against it in Syria and Iraq. Iran has provided critical military support for Bashar al-Assad and is also, in fact, building military bases at least two that we are aware of, in his country. His citizens, if you recall, at the beginning of this year, took to the streets. And they wanted a few things. Their demands were not unreasonable. They wanted their country to focus on Iran and to let Syria go by the wayside. Because, quite frankly, they had had it. They were fed up with seeing the money that should have been spent on them and their infrastructure and other needs to another country. Can you blame them? I certainly cannot. I wouldn't want to see tax dollars for my country spent in another country when my country cannot repair its roads, build a school, or provide water, power, or safe food overall. This is yet another example of a tragic crisis. Yes, it is a tragic crisis that it had to come to this. I have just a few excerpts from Nikki Haley's speech earlier this year and late last year on Iran.
All these brigades have come out to the streets. They've come out against the leader. Political prisoners must be freed. Independence, freedom, Iranian Republic. Neither Gaza nor Lebanon, my life only for Iran. Let go of Syria, think of us. We will die, but we'll take Iran back. Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, we're all together. And in reference to the Supreme Leader, quote, feel some shame. Let go of the country. Those are not my words. Those are not the words of the United States. Those are the words of the brave people of Iran.
Now,
one U.S. resident took to social media to...
This is Iran's response to this.
One U.S. resident took to social media to order the killing of 120 members of our security forces.
One U.S. resident took to social media to order the killing of 120 Iranian security forces,
threatening that those who will be included among the killed are their families, too, in their homes. This same U.S. resident publicly stated to U.S. media with complete sense of impunity that they should burn down government mosques and police stations.
All right. Unfortunately, I have hit the bottom of the hour. So I will have to pay those radio station bills. And please don't forget, you can always join me on Twitter. On Twitter at Radio Host Jesse. If you happen to be listening at 9 p.m. Eastern, Monday through Thursday, you can join me in the chat room at klrnradio.com/chat. And I might remind you that KLRN Radio is where liberty and reason still reign. All right. I will see you on the other side.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, Internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk, or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
If you're 85 or younger, would you like peace of mind and comfort for your family? We're Final Expense Direct with an urgent message for you. The average funeral today costs over $8,000, but the most you'll get from government benefits is $255. How will your family pay the difference? We can help. Our senior plans start as low as just a dollar a day and pay up to $30,000 for a funeral and other final expenses. Peace of mind is easy. There's no medical exam. You'll have lifetime coverage, and your plan can't be canceled as long as you pay your premiums. Call now for free information about our senior plans. Answer a few simple questions and receive approval right on the phone. Plus, call right now, and we'll give you a discount prescription card for free. Call 800-553-8687. That's 800-553-8687. Again, 800-553-8687.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com. Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Sometimes riders feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com. For hanging in there with me while we paid those radio station bills. Now, you have heard me refer to Guta on numerous occasions as a Holocaust. So I decided, for all concerned, to make sure we are all on the same page, I went to the Merriam-Webster Online Dictionary. They have 4 definitions, and I am going to read them all to you. A sacrifice, see sacrifice, i.e. consumed by fire. Thorough destruction involving extensive loss of life, especially through fire or a nuclear weapon, i.e. nuclear Holocaust. Usually the Holocaust, the mass slaughter of European civilians, especially Jews, by the Nazis during World War II. The last one is the definition I refer to. A mass slaughter of people, especially genocide. And they reference a Holocaust in Rwanda. Now, for a moment, I know I've been talking Iran and the nuclear deal, but we are going to back up for just a moment. I firmly believe, although unfortunately I will probably never have the proof, that when former President Obama paid the ransom for the American lives the Americans he rescued out of Iran, and trust me, I am grateful they are home. I just do not see the need for the ransom. That a large chunk of that money was paid to none other than Pyongyang. Because by this time, Iran had signed the nuclear deal, or was going to, in very short order. I don't have a timeline in front of me. I am speaking from memory. So, Iran, knowing they could not develop an intercontinental ballistic missile or a nuclear warhead on their soil, called up their buddy and fellow sanction-evading country, North Korea, and said, "Hey, have we got a deal for you? You're short on cash to develop this stuff. You could use some scientists, too. We just got a nice fat payday from the United States. We'll send you this much of it, and a few scientists, too, if you will give us the nuclear technology when you develop it." And thus spurred the leaps and bounds in North Korean technology that we have seen in the past 12 to 18 months. Before this, North Korea was making progress. However, it was much slower, and there were many more failures than there were successes. Suddenly, please accept the pun, their nuclear weapons program took off like a rocket, or like it was on rocket fuel. Take your pick. I highly doubt North Korea got there alone. I am fully willing to believe that Iran played a role.
just as it has been proven that Iran has armed the Houthi rebels. And this has been proven by none other than Nikki Haley. And she spoke late last year, reminding us how deep Iran's tentacles in the Middle East tend to run.
Aid from Iran's Revolutionary Guard to dangerous militias and terror groups is increasing. Its ballistic missiles and advanced weapons are turning up in war zones across the region. It's hard to find a conflict or a terrorist group in the Middle East that does not have Iran's fingerprints all over it.
All right, so it is hard to find a terrorist group or a conflict in the Middle East that does not have Iran's fingerprints all over it. This in stark contrast to the Ayatollah proclaiming that they have squashed regional conflicts. As much as I would appreciate anyone who can legitimately squash regional conflicts and did not entirely mind Iran battling Daesh, as long as they stayed in their corner and did not bother our troops, I do not believe that most of what they did was to quash conflict. They rather pulled out a long wooden stick and stirred the pot. Boil, boil, toil and trouble. Let's see what chaos we can make. They added fuels to fires, spurred on discontent, and encouraged people to sacrifice their own lives in destructive suicide attacks. This is not the act of someone who is a faithful actor on the world stage. Much has been made about President Trump considering to walk away from the Iran nuclear deal. I have many times repeated on these very airwaves that I believe the Iran nuclear deal is not worth the paper it is written on. I fully believe that is nothing more than a document on the trash heap of history that will not stand and has not stood the test of time. And as if this were not bad enough, remember, Iran is backing Assad. Well, pro-Syrian regime forces are building up near the U.S. troops in Syria. And they are once again conducting a buildup along the Euphrates River, near where U.S. troops are present, advising local allies. The pro-regime forces are assembling near where similar forces allied with Bashar al-Assad initiated an unprovoked attack on U.S.-backed Syrian Democratic Forces. The coalition is keeping a close eye on this activity and has been communicating with Russian counterparts via the deconfliction hotline. He said, at first we hope to de-escalate the situation. However, if it comes down to it, we will defend ourselves. The coalition is also on the lookout to see if pro-regime forces bring in any combat equipment, like artillery, that could be of a greater threat to coalition troops. Private Russian military contractors or mercenaries remain in the area and are using local pro-regime troops to scout coalition force positions. The slow buildup comes just days after pro-regime forces fired artillery rounds that landed about 1 kilometer from a U.S. allied force of Syrians operating near the coalition base at Tanaf, Syria. Coalition officials used the deconfliction line with Russian counterparts to de-escalate the incident, And this time, it worked. There were no more rounds that impacted the area after the call. Unfortunately, this has not always been the case. We're going to stay in Syria, but turn our attention to another neighboring state. Yes, there is more than one player in this game. No, not that kind of Turkey. The country of Turkey, thank you. Turkey backed Syrian rebels looted properties in Afrin after taking control of the northern city. Yes, it is a city inside the sovereign borders of Syria. And I must stop here for one brief moment to make a comparison. If Syrian borders are so porous, another country can march right across. Can you say that our current borders are in any better shape? While I don't normally bring up U.S. politics, I did want to draw that one analogy. Please, just contemplate it for yourself. Turkish forces have taken control of a city within Syria's borders. Granted, the city is on the Turkish border. However, that does not grant them the right to take it. So, Turkish-backed rebels took control of Afrin on Sunday after a two-month operation. The Turkish military forces and Turkey-backed rebels were prompting the evacuation of the majority of the city. This adds to the already concerning humanitarian situation in the area, with United Nations agencies reporting a displaced population in or from Afrin district in the hundreds of thousands who now require immediate shelter and other assistance to meet basic needs. There is also a great concern over reports of looting. And I have seen pictures, although pictures do not speak the whole story, on both social media and uniform officers. I do put a little more faith in people like this. Now, I have a couple of other smaller stories I wanted to bring you to your attention. No, I'm not going to Kim Jong-un. I'm going back to the Skripal incident, the poisoning of a former Soviet spy in the United Kingdom. Yes, there is more evidence that Russia did it. A Cold War era scientist acknowledged on Tuesday he had helped create the nerve agent, contradicting Moscow's insistence that neither Russia nor the Soviet Union ever had such a program. Professor Leonid Rink told the media that the attack did not look like Moscow's work because Skripal and his daughter had not died immediately. It is hard to believe that the Russians were involved, given all of those caught up in the incident are still alive. However, this is a sign of outrageous competence by the alleged Russian spies. This is not a good thing, not in any way, shape, or form. There is additional reporting that inspectors from the World's Chemical Weapons Watchdog have begun examining the poison used in the attack. No, not a sample similar to it, actual poison from the scene of the attack. Now, this, to me, is almost an entire, is one step short of a confession from none other than Putin himself. Now, there is more to this. Remember the 23 expelled Russian diplomats? They left. They left London for Moscow on Tuesday as the UK and Russia traded recriminations over the nerve agent attack. Prime Minister Theresa May blamed Russia for the attack. Now, of course, Russia has and will probably continue to deny any involvement in the attack. However, when you live not far from where this stuff was allegedly manufactured, and you are a former Russian spy, it would be no surprise to me if you were gunned down with such a weapon. I'm glad to see that the UK finally took a stand. Unfortunately, for the Skripals, it may be too little too late. I have one more story, and then I'd just like to visit with you for a few moments. Actually, I have two. Make that three. I guess we're doing better than I thought. I'll save the good news story for the last. We're going to briefly discuss China. Yes, we're still in the Asia-Pacific theater. President Xi Jinping won an assertive vision Tuesday of a proud and capable China, culminating an unusual legislative session that endowed him with indefinite power and sparked rare public dissent, including a few eye rolls, which some of which became famous. Xi's speech, the equivalent of an inaugural address for his second term, played up themes of tradition and nationalism that underscored a Chinese dream of restored global prominence. His words capped a legislative session at which the party sought to present China as strong, stable, and open. Xi says that it is because there will be no change in leadership. I don't understand what would keep China going down the path of Chairman Mao once again. Have they not learned from their own history? The Cultural Revolution of Mao did not end well. What makes them think that putting more power in one person's hand yet again won't have the same results? However, delegates applauded and cheered as President Xi Jinping walked out and delivered his speech at the closing session of the National People's Congress. This, to me, in many ways, is worse than a potential rigged election. At least in a rigged election, you can vote someone out. I haven't seen proof of rigged elections in Russia. However, China has essentially handed over power for life. I didn't know president of a country was a lifetime appointment in China. It wasn't, at least not up until earlier this month. Enough about China. I have two more very short, very small stories to get to. Neither one, I may mind, one is serious, and one just amused me and caught my attention. I'll go with the serious one first. The U.S. Office of Personnel Management, known as OPM, in partnership with the Defense Health Agency and the Department of Defense, announced that federal employees' dental and vision insurance program will be offered for the first time to TRICARE-eligible retirees and their families during the 2018 benefits open season. Active duty family members will be eligible to enroll in Fed VIP vision insurance. The TRICARE retiree dental program, as it currently stands, ends on December 31st, 2018. Those enrolled must choose a dental plan through Fed VIP to have coverage in 2019. Enrollment is not automatic. Most beneficiaries in TRICARE may enroll in FedVIP Now, a FedVIP vision plan. This is a comprehensive vision coverage, including eyeglasses or contacts, in addition to the routine eye exam that benefit that many beneficiaries currently have under TRICARE Prime or TRICARE Select. While this isn't an overly joyous story, it is something I felt was important to bring to you tonight. My last and final story before I spend just a moment visiting with you. This is one I just tripped over. Thankfully, it has a slightly somber note. However, you cannot dispute this person's abilities and accomplishments. Stephen Hawking. Yes, the renowned physicist Stephen Hawking, who passed away recently, his ashes will be interred near Isaac Newton's grave at Westminster Abbey. The ashes of renowned British theoretical physicist Stephen Hawking will be interred in Westminster Abbey near Isaac Newton's grave, according to representatives of the London Church. Hawking lived more than 5 decades with Lou Gehrig's disease, commonly called ALS. Yes, that's the same disease that all had us dumping buckets of ice water over our heads a few years back. Reverend John Hall, Dean of Westminster, said Hawking's ashes would be interred at the church after a service of Thanksgiving later this year, and that it is entirely fitting that the remains of Professor Hawking are to be buried in the Abbey near those of distinguished fellow scientists. Sir Isaac Newton was buried in the Abbey in 1727. Charles Darwin was buried beside Isaac Newton in 1882. Other famous scientists are buried or memorialized nearby. The most recent burial was that of atomic physicist Ernest Rutherford in 1937 and Joseph John Thomson in 1940. Well, as I didn't want to add on a sad note, this was one of the best stories I could find. And on that note, folks, just as a reminder, you can follow me on Twitter at Radio Host Jesse, and you can email me at the station at jessespov@klrnradio.com. I have one final request of you. I don't often make requests of my followers, but what would you think if I took the bumper music, Fight for the Red, White, and Blue, and I will play it, it is 14 seconds long, and I will play it for you now in my final moments.
They could fight and die for our freedom. No one had to ask them to go without a moment's hesitation. For the Red, White, and Blue.
And started playing it before I read The Names of the Fallen, which of course would be followed by Taps. I'm trying to think of a way to break up the segments just a little bit more. And I'd like your feedback on this one small issue. Again, you can always follow me on Twitter at Radio Host Jesse. Chat with me when I'm live in the chat room at klrnradio.com, where liberty and reason still reign, or email me at the station at jessespov@klrnradio.com. On that note, my friends, I will see you tomorrow night here on Jesse's POV, because I'm gone.